We're going to give God thanks. We just have to thank him for this opportunity and thank you for joining us. Tonight, in my opening, we spoke about COVID and how it hit the church. For me personally, it was something that I'll never forget. But before I go any further, I want you to hear from a very, very special person that I wanted to bring on the show, but he was just so adamant that he needed you to hear this. Watch this for a second.
Hi everyone, this is Pastor Dale Smith from Restoration City Church. I just wanted to give an update in regards to the question that Bishop Mark has proposed in terms of how the churches cope during the COVID period. During that particular period, during March, I was had to be taken into hospital for an operation, so I had to place myself on a sabbatical, which meant that the church had to be run by my leadership team. And what had happened was the sabbatical took a little bit longer than I had anticipated. And so what was good was that the way how we had to make the transition from meeting here at the church into a meeting from homes and all the different streams that we had to put in place to make sure that there was still pastoral care, where the word was still going out, where encouragement could still happen. And that was placed in the hands of the team. And what I noticed with the team was just how together they were, how united they were. And they were respectful of the fact that I was not available to be in a lot of the discussion and all of the things that they were doing. But they kept things going, which was absolutely fantastic. And I've always taught the importance of the church not being centered and focused around an individual, but that when we look at scripture, we can see it was a team ministry that we saw how Paul operated. And so I wanted to say that the whole team was fantastic, and two of the key people who were really instrumental in pulling things together for me was Brother Cleveland and my son Ariel. So I want them just to kind of share what they done and how they done it, and it was also a team effort. It wasn't just them; there were other members of the team and other people within our ministry that really worked together and pulled together so well. So I'm going to turn it over to these guys just to have to explain a little bit further about what they done. May God bless you. This is Pastor Dale.
We want to give God thanks for this opportunity. This is actually pre-recorded. We had to do it this way because obviously we understand about the law of six. And so we need to make sure we're in the government guidelines. As you know, we're in different times. I'm excited about today's interview. I'll tell you why. For me, personally, as a minister, and in my 57th year, my life is church. I know nothing else but church. I love church. My mom and my father before me grew me up in church. And so a Sunday for us was a time of getting ourselves together and going into church. Then COVID struck. We didn't know what that was about, how to handle that, because it changed the way that we did things. And I'm so passionate about tonight's interview, because I wanted to know how churches coped in the unknown called COVID-19. I know personally of churches that have said they won't go back to their churches because it's costing a lot to continue to hire the place and not go in. Many churches and pastors were meeting financial ruins. And I know that because they spoke to me. And so tonight we want to find out from individuals, how did their church deal with COVID-19 and came through it. Before I go any further, I want you to watch this video because you'll be amazed. Back in. Now, I have amazing people in this studio today. When I say amazing, I mean that. I was really privileged to speak to Apostle Smith, and he said, I don't want to take any credit. He said, these were the people that made it a difference to their church, called Restoration City Church. Two young men, one of the name of Brother Cleveland and Brother Ariel. They took responsibility for the church through COVID while their main minister recouped and got better. I want to talk with them. Thank you, Cleveland. Thank you, Ariel, for coming in.
Thank you. It's a pleasure.
Sharing.
Thank you.
I'd like to make sure, just so you speak through the mics, keep them level so you know, everyone out there is going to hear you today. Yeah. COVID hit. Pastor wasn't 100%.
Yeah.
He put the church in your hand. Navigating in a time where no other minister on the planet ever navigated the church. I want you to tell me, what did you do? How did you keep the church together? How did you reach out? Cleveland, tell me, what did you do?
I think the first thing we focused on was people. We said, church is the people. It's not just the building. So it was getting our messages right. So when I used to watch the TV, everything was about, this is closing down. Businesses are closing. Cinemas are closing. Churches are closing. And what rose in my spirit was, the church is not closed.
Come on.
The church isn't closed. We're deployed. If we're talking about we're like an army, we're deployed.
You're deployed.
We are not closed down. Right. No one can close down my prayer. No one can close down my praise.
Come on.
And no one can close down my worship. But the wording which was coming out, what I was hearing, and even from some of the churches and church people, was church is closed. No, it's not closed. Church is the people.
Mm-hmm.
So our focus switched straight onto the people. Where are our people?
Mm-hmm.
And we asked ourselves this. We WhatsApp messaged to each other. Me and Ira were in touch. And some of the other congregation, we were messing each other constantly. Because
mm-hmm.
we needed to know where our people were. And how were our people doing?
And your senior pastor gave you that responsibility to move the church forward.
Our pastor's always given us that responsibility.
Beautiful.
He said, he knows we're not just to sit down in church.
Yeah. Beautiful.
He's never preached to say we're just to sit down and listen to him. He's always preached that it's our responsibility. It's our church. It's
so
our
empowered
people.
Empowered you to
yeah,
get on.
Yeah. Yeah.
Even in this. I mean, Ariel, I mean, come, I'm getting excited here. What was the people's feeling when this happened, when they know they couldn't go into their own building? You've got a beautiful building, I know it. How did they feel?
I'm sure everyone felt a bit disappointed that they couldn't go back into the building.
Mm-hmm.
And obviously I knew that. I knew people would be disappointed and not be able to, you know, be in the house of God with everyone. And so I tried to make sure that we done online services and make sure that we made it in, try to engage mm-hmm. as much people as we could. So I knew with our church, for example, we are worshiping church. So I knew, okay, you know what? We got to have some worship.
So how did you do this? So how did you get the worship? You couldn't go into your building.
So what we've done is, thankfully I had some equipment at home. So I took some equipment from church
mm-hmm.
and then brought it to my house. And mm-hmm. I had to learn stuff like, for example, play the keys. I had to learn how to play keys, try to myself around different stuff which I've never done before, because again, this we've never had this before.
What technology did you use to reach the people?
So we had like camera. So we had a camera because we were live streaming beforehand anyway.
Okay.
But we just pre-recorded some of the services. So we used the camera. What else did we use? I just used a software that I had on my laptop
mm-hmm.
and just edited from there.
Fine. Okay.
Yeah, yeah.
Cleveland, let me come back to you. Your pastor praises you guys for the way you got the church mobilized. How did you reach them? What other means did you use to reach them? Was anybody in a position where they were lacking anything, food, stuff like that? Because they weren't sure.
Yeah, well, that was our first question when we started really with WhatsApp. Then we moved to Zoom and Hangouts, house party. We were just trying different formats to see which one would work with the different technologies, because I'm a person who loves tech.
Okay.
But I understand that the different people have different phones and different generations. Things won't work on every platform. Mm. So it was trying to get that understanding of where people were. And we found that actually Hangouts worked the best because it was most simple.
It's Hangouts.
It's an app you can use. You can download onto your phone.
A Hangout.
Yeah, called Hangouts. Yeah. It's a Google app. It's on the Play Store. And it's free.
Mm-hmm.
And it seemed to work on most of the formats.
Mm-hmm.
So even before COVID, we were starting to use technology a little bit more. We were trying to experiment with different things. Yeah, we can reach different groups because we understand people are busy. They've got different things to do on the daytime. So we thought, what can we do to actually bring everyone into the one space? And we were doing cell groups around at my house, and people were coming around.
Beautiful.
At first, and we were sitting down. We were talking over the Bible. We were challenging each other. We were growing. And then COVID came, and that stopped.
All right. Before you go any further, I want to know. So you had something before COVID hit. So you had the technology that was around.
Well, we had technology, but we weren't using it to mimic what we were doing live.
Mm-hmm.
We were just using it just to reach out to people. So, for instance, we'd have meetings coming up. So whether we do that on WhatsApp, we do a slide and send that out.
Ooh.
You know, we were doing different things in order to try and engage with the our members.
Well done. I mean, so that means it's like a precursor. It was like something was happening. You wouldn't have known, but you had that as it were, in a sense that you've got something going. So when this hit, you knew exactly to round to. Now, did you get any support from other churches that may have thought, how could you do that? Or did you share the resources?
Yeah, so my cousin does exactly the same thing as I do in terms of working the media and doing the music. And so between me and him, he was giving me some advice. I was
good.
Him some advice,
sharing good practice.
So yeah, so we were just like just bouncing off one another, just bouncing ideas. Mm-hmm. Yeah, so definitely got some help from him and some help from us. So yeah, we were all learning, and I was just learning from different churches as well, phoning different people. Was like, what did you do? How did you do that? And I was just like a sponge, just getting as much information as I could.
And we also got lots of help from our members.
Yeah. Tell me, what do you mean?
They just, the people within our church just mobilized. It was like, Cleve, I know how to do that. You know, I do health and safety as well. Well, I know how to do health and safety. We know we have to get COVID prepared.
Good.
There were people who were bringing their skills from the workplace into the church.
Into the
and
church,
it was just happening organically. It was just happening straight away. So I was getting messages from different members. And I thought, you could feel something was happening. Now all we had to do was plan and put framework around it.
So out of this chaos, creativity emerged.
Yes.
100%.
Yeah.
100%.
Now, I'm always, interested about the senior citizens. I don't know what the age limits are in your ministry, but how did you cater, if any, for the senior? Those that may not be tech savvy, didn't know how to go, but how would you communicate how they could not be left out? Because that can happen.
Yep.
What did you do in that area, if you do have any senior citizens?
Well, I don't really have senior citizens, but there was
older.
A few, we've got some older folk, but there was a few people that did struggle with the tech side.
Right.
So obviously I took time to go through step by step of what to do. So for example, we said, okay, we want to hear from the congregation.
Mm-hmm.
So we said, all right, everyone send in your clips, share a minute of your testimony, let everyone see how you're doing. And some didn't know what portrait and landscape meant. Sometimes, you know, they'll have the washing machine and going in the background, and it's just like, oh, come on. So, So, it was hard, but they managed to get it. So obviously, I just, you know, WhatsApp them, okay, step one, step two, step three. So it was just breaking it.
And phone calls
really.
As well.
And phone calls.
And when we were phoning them, it was like, right, download Microsoft Teams. It looks like this.
Brilliant.
And then taking our time and being patient with them, understanding that that may not have been their world.
Yeah.
So they might understand it. So it was being patient and saying, right, step by step, we're taking it slowly. And then reward, once they've done it, says, I send them a little smiley face.
Excellent.
You're on, Teams. Welcome.
Let me, I tell you, when I spoke to your leader, Pastor Delroy Smith, he was just, I wanted to bring him on, but he said, no, I'm not taking any credit. I'm giving it to these guys who navigated the church through COVID. And I believe, you know, this is a prime example of how we are we were made in his image. A God of creativity now have emerged. Now, here's the thing, and I want to just round this up. The whole idea of people coming in is able to finance the church. It's up to you. I'm not getting in your business, but would you say that the church, because it's been educated, you're able to keep the same level of giving? People are still giving, still supporting the ministry, even when you weren't able to go inside the building?
Yeah, so what I did is I managed to set up different ways in which we could give. So we thought of an idea of doing a drive-through, give and go. So
say it again.
Give and go.
Give and go.
Yeah. So if people wanted to like drop their offering by the church, I can just post
it. Brilliant.
Yeah. And we also have a thing called Tithely app as well. Tithely app.
Tithely app.
Yeah. So it's a platform for different churches where you can do online giving. So we had that option available.
Brilliant.
Also bank transfer as well. So I made sure, I done my research, make sure that it was legit. So that way people can still give online. So no excuses.
Fantastic.
And our members were also, have to be said as well, congratulated because they were putting gift packages together and taking them up to like the women's refugees and stuff like that.
Fantastic.
So they were making sure this wasn't just for coming in for us, it's making sure we were giving out all the time as well. That was our key thing, is we've got to support people around because this is the time when people really need it.
So now it was church without walls.
Yes.
We were now fulfilling the biggest commission of all times.
That's right.
Where we are now going beyond the four doors. Yes?
Yep.
This is interesting. But I just love the way you mobilized yourselves together. And I want to commend you. Because, as I said, most churches have not survived. But I hope and trust that everything I've heard today, you would be able to share that. It's kingdom at the end of the day.
Yes,
we're all on the same level playing field. And I just commend you for what you've done. You know what I'm going to ask you to do? Just tell me, are you online on Sunday mornings?
Yeah, so we're live on Sundays.
Please, just tell them.
11 o'clock.
That's your tell
Restoration
them.
City Church, UK. 11 o'clock on Facebook and YouTube.
Sundays. Yep.
I'm happy for you.
We also do midweek stuff. We do a morning reflection, 7 o'clock in the morning.
7 o'clock.
On Microsoft Teams. Yeah, we go from 7 till 8 and we encourage each other. We play some songs of worship and praise. And on a Wednesday, we have a meeting that we do where we just go into the Word and we challenge each other and we learn more and we actually check in with each other, because this has always been about our mental, physical and our spiritual health. So we've made sure that we're trying to cater for each of those and we haven't left anything out. We've got a series called Restoration Talks. That's with our own psychologist, Dr. Amanda Bennett.
Your own psychologist?
Yes, our own. And she does those talks. So for the mental side of things, we're making sure we're
a lot of mental.
We're looking after that side of it. Yeah. The spiritual side, we've got our Wednesdays where we're going into the Word. And for the physical side, we're just challenging each other. When we get to meet, we could meet. We did. When we could go to the park, we met up in the park because we knew that contact and seeing each other was a good thing. So we met at Lloyd's Park as a group, and we just sat down, had some food, and did a quiz.
Listen, guys. Time's running out. You have inspired me. You, without a doubt, has survived COVID. And everything you've said today, I do believe people have heard and will take it on board. I want to do this. I've got to pray for you. Father, in the name of Jesus, I thank you. I thank you so much that the church, when it's under pressure, emerges. It gets stronger. Father, we will not back down because the foundation is Jesus Christ. And it's on that foundation, Father, that the church will thrive. So we thank you for the man of God. We thank you for Cleveland and for Ariel. We thank you for the way they've taken the mantle on with their pastor and blessed the congregation. Bless them and bless that ministry, because we have to survive COVID. And we give you thanks and give you praise. in Jesus' name.
Amen.
God bless you. It's great having you.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you. God bless. Well, yes, I always say no condition is permanent. We can survive because we are made in His image, and therefore creativity will burst through chaos. God bless you. Wasn't that great? Have you heard how two men under their great leader, exemplary leadership, was able to maneuver the church? I'm using that word, navigate the church. The church is built on the foundation, Jesus Christ alone. I'm excited that the church will and must survive COVID. Look, I have two great people in the studio today, good friends. And I want to introduce them to you. And they're going to give you their own personal experience of how they survive COVID. We've got not other than Pastor Dion Lamont from Dunamis.
From Perfecting Dunamis
Church.
Yes.
Which is lovely to have you today.
God bless you. Thank you for the invitation, Bishop.
I know you're going to be a blessing. You're going to be able to speak into their lives. And we also have Bishop-elect Winston Carnegie from Ecclesia Ministries from Milton Keynes.
Thank you, Bishop. Good evening. Thanks for having us.
It's a privilege having you here. And I'm sure you both are going to download. And please, we're going to have church in here, but we want you to encourage those out there. COVID is real. It's hit the church like we've never thought it would have ever hit anything else. And plus, we've never seen anything like this in our lifetime. And so it brings me on to the question, how did we navigate through it? Pastor Lamont, when COVID came, when it came and all of a sudden we were not able to meet in our churches, I want you to explain and share with me, what was your first initial reaction when this happened?
It's very interesting, Bishop, because we actually, in Perfecting Dunamis, we actually closed down before the lockdown.
Wow.
Because the Bible talks about seeing the signs, you know. You can tell what's going to happen by looking in the sky, by looking at the weather. And so we were almost like prophetic meteorologists. We were able to read.
Say that again, please. Prophetic meteorologists. Go ahead. Come on.
So we were able to read the weather patterns and exactly what
sounds
was happening
in the
atmosphere.
Go ahead.
And having oversight over a flock, and the Bible says in Acts 28 that God has made you overseers over the flock, of which the Holy Ghost has made you overseers to feed the church of God, which He has purchased with His own blood.
Mm.
God, because He warned them that grievous wolves was going to come in and they wouldn't spare the flock. That means that we ought to have responsibility for the individuals, for the lives, for the giftings that God has placed within and entrusted to us.
Good word.
And so I had to then look at the signs. I have elderly people in my congregation, young mothers, young people, people with underlying health issues.
Come on.
So it was not responsible action for me to just see that. So even whether or not the government was going to lock down or not, I was going to say, look, we need to look at a different way that we can meet, and because people were experiencing this. So we locked down before lockdown.
Mm-hmm.
And then now going on Zoom and meeting like this was not strange to us, because when the weather in winter time is very bad, when snow is high and it's frosty and whatever, we shut down and we meet via conference calls, or we meet via technology.
So you've always done
that. Is something that we've always done. However, never on this scale. Never for this length of time,
right.
Bishop.
Yeah.
You know. And so I mean, as a segue, we are saying that members are becoming a little bit. I sent a letter out to Perfecting Dunamis, and I know that you're suffering from Zoomitis. And
Zoomiitis.
I know you've got Zoomiitis, and I know that kind of thing. But we've got to keep going. We've got to keep going. And people said our members are getting a little bit weary. But pastors are getting weary in a different way. Mm-hmm. Now let me say this. How about the fact that on a Sunday you can be with your family, you can cook together, eat together, sit down, catch up on TV, watch those kind of things. You can think, I can get used to this. I can get used to this. Maybe on a Saturday night, Friday night, when you'd be laboring in prayer and the word for whatever. Now, you know, it's now. I find it harder.
Come on, break that down.
I'm finding.
What are you finding harder?
Maybe it's psychological.
Uh-huh.
But I am finding it harder. I'm a very open person.
I want
person
you to like be.
That.
Yeah.
I'm finding it more difficult psychologically, and I'm not going to go as far to say emotionally in this context.
Mm-hmm.
I'm finding it more of a drain psychologically.
Interesting.
And because now, who are you preaching to?
Standing in a room.
I thought they said that. You're mad if you talk to yourself.
Okay.
But here we are.
Go on.
Preaching, and you have to make sure now, are you as anointed as you've been telling people all these years?
All right.
Because you're going to have to really grab, at least when we were meeting physically, you could see if this one is sleeping. Mm-hmm. You can see if this one is baby crying. You can see if that one is taking, you can see people looking at their watch.
Right.
You can see whatever. You can see who's coming in late. Now.
None of that.
You don't have any of that. Right. You just have to trust God and what you're saying, that people are actually coming on and listening to you. Plus, they have the choice of looking at the broadcast 4 days before, Saturday before the next one on Sunday. Mm-hmm. They can go on and have a look. So these are really trying times, more than just for the obvious reasons. But the Bible tells us about when iniquity shall abound, the love of many will wax cold. And I can see that this coldness, this pandemic is wax, this iniquity that is in our society today. It's like almost being indoors. The fire of God is almost been ebbed out and there's nothing to melt the wax.
Okay, Pastor, let's look. I'm saying I stand up there on a weekly basis sometimes. And yeah, it takes much. You're preaching to the benches, the chairs, and you'll get the odd yes, amen, whatever. And I'm grateful that you are able to talk about what it's doing to you as a preacher.
Yes, Bishop.
And I think that's why I say, who ministers to the minister?
But we're not real, Bishop. I don't mean it in the sense that we don't say we're real. I mean, to some congregants, we're not real people.
Come on.
To some congregants, you don't have emotional crisis. To some congregants, you're not going to be sitting down there and crying, God, when is this happening? Is this the end of what is this? What am I doing? Should I go back fishing?
Mm-hmm.
What is this, God? What is happening here
in this season?
Uh-huh. In this season, you know, because I need to eat. I've got bills to pay.
Right.
I've got everything else to happen. There are people. There are pastors who are losing their homes.
Come on.
They're losing their relationships.
Come on.
They're losing the physical building that they and then
so they paid thousands and,
they're paid
of pounds.
Thousands
for.
Of pounds for. They yeah. still have that mortgage. You can't just go to the mortgage lenders and say, you know what? Can I just lay my hands on you and pray and say hallelujah? You know, these things are real. People are real. It is having a real impact. But before I hand over, the question is really how, but we are surviving. We are still surviving because we don't know when this is going to end.
Come on.
This could go into this time next year. We don't know because of what the politicians, because of what all of these epidemiologists and the virologists are doing, because of the, this is now a politicized pandemic.
Oh, don't go. Okay.
So because it's politicized, we don't know what their end result. What is their end result? What is it that they want to achieve before they lift everything? It is just that people must get better because there's always going to be sickness. When you measure how many people have died from COVID compared to how many people have died from influenza per year and whatever, but there is something that is intrinsically different. Those are two words that people know me by. Because this is intrinsically different, then there is a different way to approach it. And I want to say that however we come out of this, the Church of the Living God has withstood persecution before.
That's right.
Is this persecution? This is something that cannot break the church. You may get broken and you may fall away, but the Church of God is going to stand. Be encouraged. This is not the time to be making rash decisions. This is not the time to stay away from each other. This is not the time not to join into prayer meetings. This is the time for the church to come together and do what we do best, and that is pray. And that's how we have survived in Perfecting Dunamis. We had 20 days of prayer, just 20 days, nonstop. We saw prognosis of cancer stopping. We saw tumors melting. We saw relationships went up. We spent 20 days in prayer, and every night the Zoom call was filled. People tuned in because they know I am a person of prayer. That's where I win. That's where I grow. That's where I conquer. I've got to be on my knees. Okay. That's how we survive.
Wow.
God bless.
That's how you surprise.
Over and out.
Okay. I hear that. As I said, everybody has a different journey on this, and I'm great. I mean, let me just bring in Bishop. I mean, yeah. Bishop, it's great having you. Wonderful. I would like to ask you as well, how have your ministry survived? What technology are you using? And how would you encourage those outside that, we are surviving this and we will?
That's a good question, Bishop. And the word survival or surviving, I mean, Pastor Lamont
She's always went there.
It is both thriving and surviving.
That's a good word.
Thriving and surviving. Pastor Lamont, you mentioned 20 days in prayer. That's thriving because the gates of hell shall not prevail against the church of God. Three words come to mind, and that is connectivity, creativity, and productivity. And I'm picking that up in what you say. I think what's so great about that this tonight, Bishop, is you've opened a forum, and I think we all need to have a space like this.
Yeah, who ministers to connect? The ministers. We need to be open and honest.
And I think in the connectivity, as we're doing tonight, it brings the creativity
good
that will bring the productivity.
Oh, wow.
And this is...
you could have said that one more time.
The connectivity. We're connecting tonight and feeding from the energy of Pastor Lamont. You're going to get creative enough to become productive.
Like bringing it to the...
That's right. And something you said, which is so fantastic, is that you locked down before the lockdown. They didn't lock you down. You know, the way to fight fire is with fire.
Okay.
If they ablaze, if the desert is on fire, whoa, they don't put the fire engine in. They go ahead and set fire over there. And when the fire reached the fire, and so you shut down before. Unfortunately, we got locked down. We weren't, you know, it's unprecedented
time. Of course it is.
I mean, Joshua, getting ready to cross over. And this is probably prophetic, Pastor Angie. He's getting ready after 40 years with a new generation to go into something completely
new. Of course.
And watch this. And I don't want it to be too prophetic here. They're about to go into the promised land. And Joshua says something like this.
I told you
this is
going to be incredible. Come on.
We've never been this way before. Yet God took them out of Egypt. That's miracle enough. 40 years in the wilderness, and they come to the brink of that place they've never seen before. And they said, we have never seen this before. And that always comes as God is organizing you for a breakthrough.
Wow.
Whatever system, I mean, Canaan was a system that was there. I mean, actually, God said to Canaan, said to the children of Israel, he said, I am actually not going to drive your enemies out before you because the land will swallow you. Mm-hmm. So they were going into, if you like, a pandemic. They were going into a situation that they had no control over, but God was with them. And I think what happened, just you know, it was on the Monday I was having a conversation with one of the members of the church.
Mm-hmm.
And and she was talking about the virus, and she said, you know, I have a good friend in Hong Kong.
Mm-hmm.
And she was saying that she can't understand how we are so forward thinking, and yet we're suffering, and Hong Kong is not suffering. And she asked him, why? And the gentleman said, because we locked down. We closed the schools. We closed, you know, public places.
Mm-hmm.
And I thought, wow. And I got to thinking that I may need to do something. That's on the Monday. And I went home on the Monday and looked at the Zoom, because some of my clients are on that. We have meeting on Zoom. But I've never had it.
So you never experienced Zoom before?
Never experienced Zoom before. And we were doing, our website was up for quite a few years, and we decided to take it down, mm-hmm. and go back to the drawing board. So we had no social outlet at mm-hmm. all. And so instead of panicking, we went and we got the Zoom situation sorted. And by Thursday, the congregants were calling. What are we going to do? What are we going to do? Because Friday, they were talking about pulling the kids out of school and everything.
Right.
And we were ready for Sunday morning. What I found, Pastor Lamont, I don't know if you found it. People always look to leadership.
Okay. Now you touch a very important part.
Yeah.
Look to leadership.
Yes.
In times of chaos.
In times of chaos. I mean, this is church. Probably we didn't realize, like you're saying, pastors have to, and I like what you say, sometimes we don't go to sleep on a Sunday, no. on a Saturday night, because even though you got that message all week, mm-hmm. you're working on it, Saturday night it turns to Chinese, and you've got to go back, you've got to go back into it again. And so what I didn't realize, that although we are the church, you are the church. When there's a crisis moment, everything is on your shoulder. Every single thing is on your shoulder. And you become the church. And they look to you because it's a hopeless situation.
So what happens if they look to the church or the leaders, and the leader is not able to come to that level to suffice the body? What happens?
I believe that that's a good question. And I'm going to ask Pastor Lamont, because she's there. But you know what I found? I found this, that whenever God calls a man, whatever situation he or she enter into, doesn't matter whether it's flood, fire, whatever it is, he equips them for it.
Okay.
And it's those situations that pull you to the next level.
And that's the only way we're going to come through.
That's
this.
The only way. Look at Moses. He was brought up in Egypt. He was cultured in the arts of Egypt. I mean, he was in the king's palace. He spent years in the king's palace. I think he probably left there when he was 40 years old. 40 okay. years anyway. You know, but listen, God is calling him to go lead his people. And Moses is talking about, I am eloquent. I can't speak. And he's fearful mm-hmm. in meeting Pharaoh. But what did God do? He equipped him. And I believe that every leader deep down inside is equipped to deal with moments of crisis all the way through history.
You need to say that again. You believe that every leader?
Yeah. Whoever God has called to stand, whoever God has called
right.
to stand in a place. We see it in Jeremiah. We see it in Moses. We see it in Samuel. Samuel didn't even know the voice of God, mm-hmm. but he was called. We see it in David. David, who trained David about palace etiquette and behavior? Who trained him?
God called him.
Whenever somebody said that, you must have heard this, that God doesn't call the qualified, but he qualifies the call.
Yes. Could I say that again? I'll look at the camera and just
yes.
say that.
It's important. That God doesn't call the qualified, but he qualifies the call. There is something in you when God calls you. I heard a story. Not so long ago, well, it was quite a few years ago now, a preacher was talking about a waterfowl, a water bird, somewhere in the Indian hemisphere somewhere. And scientists has always wondered why every time they're going to hatch the eggs, they go from the water right up into the tree and put the eggs up in the tree and hatch the eggs. They could never work it out. So they took the eggs, brought it into the lab, mm-hmm. and created a situation where they hatched. mm-hmm. the chickens, and they wouldn't feed. They wouldn't feed. They would die. They couldn't understand why those birds were dying. And then one day,
lift up your voice. We'll hear.
Yeah. One day. Mm-hmm. One day, one of the scientists really looked at this, and he noticed that the hen or the bird went up again with the eggs in the tree, and he noticed that every single one of the little chicks didn't walk down out of the tree. They all fell to the ground.
Mm-hmm.
And then they got up and they wobbled and the mother fed them and they ate. And what I learned from that is that these birds, these waterfowl, has something built into their DNA.
Mm-hmm.
Unless they come into impact on the ground, they hunger cannot be created. Hunger is created on impact. And so that's why the ones they hatched in the lab never worked, because they never had impact. God has put something in us to respond to impact. You know, you talk about fasting 20 days, 21 days, we do 40 days. When something really gets in our skin and we don't know how we're going to navigate it, whether it's a virus or whatever it is, when we get in that prayer room and we decide to starve the flesh to feed the spirit, there's something that impacts in the spirit, that switches something on in you and I, where we begin to see what we could not see before.
Bishop, let's look.
Sorry.
We're actually dealing with exemplary leadership in a time of crisis such as COVID.
Yes.
Because we're talking about how we're going to survive that. Now, how do we reach out to other ministers who are suffering in this area, don't know who to talk? That's why I always use the word, who ministers to the minister? And I love the whole idea of impact. We have to respond.
Yes, yes.
We have to respond because we have a responsibility, as Pastor said, to the flock.
Yes.
How are we doing that in this? Because suppose people just get lazy now and think, you know what? It's coming through the TV. I can watch it maybe 4 days after. Maybe all of a sudden, when the day does come that we got to get back to church, I'm not feeling that because I'm so used to being at home. I may have even got a job on a Sunday now because of the situation. And now it's going to stop me from coming to church. I mean, how do we as ministers address that area, especially seniors? It's a loaded question here. We even senior citizens, how do we grapple around them? How can we assure them, even going back into our churches with all the bits and pieces in place, that they're safe?
As Pastor Lemon's going to take that one.
How can we assure that they're safe coming back to church?
Can I just say this? The first protocol, I think, is the first part of your question, is encouraging the shepherds, the pastors. And I think that yourself, you're a good example, and all the other pastors out there with any kind of network at all.
Okay.
To get this dialogue going,
right.
Creativity, connectivity, get the dialogue going, do it on Zoom, whatever, and talk to us and the pastors with the small church who doesn't really own a building.
So they need to talk up.
I think we need to connect and share as pastors, because you're talking about feeding the flock, but the pastors at this particular time, Pastor, you mentioned about, you know, trying to preach across a camera with nobody sitting there. Last Saturday, I live in Milton Keynes, and I went to the Don's ground last Saturday. My daughter was staying there, so I went by there just to see her, and the match was on. And I saw all the coaches. I didn't see any fans. I couldn't hear any noise, and I went in, and the guy said, I said, is there a match on today? He said, oh, yeah, there's a match on today. I said, where are all the fans? He said, they're at home. I said, how? How are they going to play? He said, it's virtual. So footballers are playing. And so people, you know, how do they just like how they have to play.
They're adjusting.
We have to preach. It's difficult to preach to your camera. You know what I mean? So we need to encourage the shepherd so they can encourage the sheep.
Okay. This is how it is. This is how we have to do. We get tired. I mean, what's your response to that, Pastor? You know, we've got a lot of work.
Mm.
How about, are you also empowering the other leaders
Well, I have a Saturday Bible study on Zoom. It's mostly people from outside of the UK that I speak into their lives and look at various,
excellent,
do hermeneutics actually and look at various ways. Word. But this is an interesting thought, and I know we're on camera, but I don't say something unless, you know, I can back it up. Now, the interesting thing is, the saying is that if no one is following you, you're taking a walk.
Right.
Okay.
Wow.
So first of all, we need to understand that the power really lies within the people.
Mm-hmm. Yes. Laodicea.
It is its power. It's, you know, we like to power it. It's that way, you know, the old story of God. People were looking to find God, and they went up in the steep, and he said, "No, go back down. I dwell among the people."
Right.
You know, the power is in the people. So really, if nobody followed your vision, if no one turns up to church, forget about pandemic for a moment. If the people decide that they're not coming to church on that Sunday, or they're not coming to Bible study, or they're not coming to the seminar. Mm. What happened?
Where is the power?
You're still, are you the leader? So people, congregation and pastor, congregation and bishop, congregation and leader must work hand in hand.
Yes.
We cast the vision and make it plain, and they that run by will read it, and they will herald the vision, and they will proclaim the vision. So the responsibility of leaders and leadership really is to be sound in what you're saying, is to cast the vision and make sure that it is clear. We see in this country at the moment, you know, in this democracy, we see what is the prime minister doing? He's not clear. People are confused and that sort of thing. So that's exactly the same thing. It's leadership. That's exactly the same thing. Yeah. We need to be very clear in what we are saying. We need to be consistent. So if you're having a Zoom call and only 3 people out of 50 or whatever turn up have the Zoom call.
Yes.
Have the prayer meeting. If you cancel it because they're not coming, the power is shifted.
Right.
The power is shifted. Continue to do what you will do, because trust me, when they get hungry, the saying is you can lead a horse to the water, but you can't make him drink. I disagree. I'm known for examining statements. It used to be fine when we were saying it. I disagree. If you put salt in the horse's mouth, that you won't have to lead the horse to the water.
Jesus, have mercy.
The horse will look for water.
You know.
The horse will look. Oh, come on, don't get me. The horse will look for water.
So if
we keep being consistent with what we are doing, create a thirst. We are the salt of the earth. Create a thirst and let people come after it.
But time is going. Viewers are watching. Just give me two. Give me a minute on that. Yeah, because I've got to close this up, because I need to go to the next level on this. But just give me a minute, because I need us to talk also. Yeah, put salt in their mouths. Wow. Put salt in their mouths. I really want to also under that.
Yes.
Is surviving this COVID, making the church relevant, assuring the church. Are you saying to me it's really down to leadership? And who's ministering to other churches? Is there any reaching out to others during this time in your ministry?
I do. We do.
Could you share reaching out instead of the inclusiveness? Because we sing the song, "You in My Small Corner and I in you in your small corner and I
rhyme.
In us." Yes. That don't work. We need to begin to work together. Churches coming together, sharing resources. That's really what I want to hear.
Yes.
Are you doing this in your fellowship in this time? Time is moving, but please, could you just share that? Are you sharing resources?
I'm actually helping going other to get churches. Pastor Lamont to come and minister to us across the way, because I'm just so impacted by her persona and what she's doing. Share that with us.
God bless
but
you.
I actually, we reach across, we like you, Pastor Lamont, we have people connecting from the United States, people from Jamaica, Guam, South Korea, from India, And we just launched, in the midst of this, we launched our first international service the week before last. And our bishop from the United States opened that service. One of the bishops from the United States opened that service. I would never have done that international service because there was no way I could have linked that up together.
So what are you saying? You're saying COVID, in a sense, has turned a lot of things around for the good.
There's some positivity that's come out of it.
There's positiveness that's come out of COVID for the body of Christ.
Yes.
Definitely.
Yes. That, the number of people that we're reaching, the number of people that
would not normally come through the church doors.
Never come through the church doors. So for me, Bishop Mark, is we cannot go back to how we were.
Wow.
We cannot. We're going to have workshops and seminars on how to reach people via the social media platforms, how to build that. At the moment, there is a course that I'm about to take regarding this. How do you become evangelists? If you understand, even with iPhones and Apple and whatever, they call their salesperson evangelists. Mm-hmm. How you go out. Yes, how you go out and catch them, how you go out and sell it. We're going to have to know how to develop Facebook from Instagram to YouTube to whatever it is. We're going to have to learn now how to be strategic. We've got young people in our midst who they know it. Know it. Release them. Lay hands on them. Release them and let them and let them come along and say, Pastor, this is what you do. This is how you do it. That's release them. It is not just, leadership means that. Yeah. Leadership
empowering
is not just you
them,
standing around the pot.
Them.
Leadership is just saying, look, you don't have all the skills in this area, but you do.
Excellent.
So I will spot that in you. I would allow you to do that. It's not the time for leaders to feel threatened and precious and what they can't take away what is yours.
I think, Pastor Lamont, that is what's making it work for us as well. Is that because we don't have the congregation, we can't see the person nodding off, and we don't have that body contact. We
I'm gonna give you a virtual high five.
Yes, we're actually having to use. We've gone from three services a week to 7 nights per week and 3 times on Sundays
in the COVID period.
Because of the COVID period, and it means that every member of our church is actively doing something. And we're all sitting, listening to them, ministering to us. For instance, we have a young gentleman, he's 15 years old. He leads a quiz challenge on a Sunday evening.
That's beautiful.
We have a young lady that's just started uni in London. She did excellently last year at SOAS with honors and everything. So she's come back this year to do her master's. And she just started what we call the young adults movement. And you want to get your young people in on that. And it's where they say, look, between 20 and 30, we want to talk about our stuff. We have moms and dads over us. But look, relationships, mates,
nice.
How are we managing in university? How are we navigating through COVID, And so I'm asking pastors, let your young people get online. You can get online, blank yourself out, just let them talk. That's come out of COVID for us. Fear, handling fear has come out of COVID
Absolutely.
For us.
Oh, yeah.
Talking to you tonight, has encouraged me to go and encourage someone else. Yeah. I've got 9 churches in India that are our churches. And beyond that, the other churches that are connected to them because of us.
Can I just stop you right there? Because this is going to be the time of ministry, okay? And I feel we need to do this. And I want you to pick a camera right now. And I want you to encourage a ministry, a pastor, even a viewer at this moment who may be feeling hard done by because of what's happening, furloughed, lost job, even suffering from COVID. But I want you to speak to the camera and tell them that we're going to make this. Mm. We're going to come through this. God's going to do something. He's going to turn all this around for our good.
Hallelujah.
The church thrives under pressure. And I want you right now, like you would do, and look into that camera, and I want you to minister Hallelujah. As we close this session.
I want to pray with
give God. Her pray hope with out there that God is going to turn this around.
Hallelujah.
We will emerge.
Hallelujah.
Go ahead.
Hallelujah.
God.
Paraphrasing from Genesis chapter 1, If you look at the very beginning, in the beginning was Word. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. And whatever, there's something that's very intriguing that sometimes we may read and overlook. It starts off by talking about that darkness covered the earth, and it was because darkness covered the earth that God said, let there be light. So darkness comes before light. There's darkness, and then God will speak into the light. Follow that right throughout the scriptures, and you will see that there's a pattern where things get dark. It's, a weeping may endure for a night. Joy comes in the morning. Have a look at the Bible says, and the evening, and the morning was the first day. It starts off in the evening time. It's always darkest before the dawn. You may be going through your dark situation right now, your night situation right now. You may be filled with fear and intrepidation. You may be filled with despair. You may be filled with depression. There may be suicidal thoughts. Yes. Yes, Pastor, I'm talking to you. Yes, Bishop, I'm talking to you. You may be experiencing suicidal thoughts. The devil may be bombarding your mind, because that's where the battleground is. It's in your mind. He sent out his marshals. He sent out and deployed all of his greatest ammunition against your mind. I'm losing my ministry. People are leaving. No money is coming in. It's bombarding your mind. But tonight, in the name of Jesus, we draw the bloodline around your mind. In the name of Jesus, I want you to open your eyes, men and women of God. I want you to open your eyes and see that there are chariots of fire gathered around you. You may be in your Dothan, and you may feel that everyone is coming against you, and the army is greater than what you have. It may seem like this pandemic is greater than what you have, but I want you to anoint your stuff right now in the name of Jesus. Utilize your praise in the name of Jesus. Wield that praise, that sword high. Cut off Goliath's head right now in the name of Jesus. You have been trained. You've killed your lion. You've killed your bear. It's time for you to face the Goliath known as pandemic. And his head will come off. And his brothers will, they too will be defeated. Everything to do with coming against your ministry. How dare he? We are more than conquerors in the name of Jesus Christ. You will survive. You will thrive. You will grow. You will be creative. You will produce. You will make it. You will get over it. You're going to climb over that hill. You're going to climb over that mountain. And you will live and follow the trajectory of God. God bless you in Jesus' name.
Word, I tell you.
Hallelujah.
One foundation.
Word. That's a word.
We will make it through. Come on.
We will make it through.
Look into the camera and speak.
We want to pray. Just join hands with Pastor Lamont, because she mentioned that prayer gene, and I feel it. I am a prayer gene. My spiritual father is a prayer warrior, and that I don't need another word on top of that. We just need to pray some stuff. I like that word. Amen. The book of Psalm said, let me get to it. Psalm 102. It says, "Thou shalt arise and have mercy upon Zion, for the time to favor her." Yeah, the set time is come.
Set time.
The set time is come. God has a set time.
Come on.
It's in the middle of a pandemic. It may be in the middle of a Red Sea.
Whoa.
It may be in the river, in the middle of a Jordan.
Come on.
But the promised land is just ahead of you. The thing is, God is not a God that gives up. Amen. It is a God that lifts up, picks up. He does not give up.
He doesn't give up. He lifts up.
He lifts up. He lifts up the poor and the needy out of the dunghill.
Come on.
So I am encouraging you. You may have a small church, but you have a big God.
Hallelujah.
That is the good thing. You have a mustard seed faith, and that's all you need to remove that mountain.
Come on.
And I want to lift a prayer up today and make a declaration. The word is on the floor. That was the word that we needed today.
Come on.
That was the word. Zion is the church of Jesus Christ.
Come on.
And the church is known for going through the fire.
Come on.
It's made to go through
Jesus
the flood.
Jesus have mercy.
It is made to live in Egypt. It is made to wander in the desert for 40 years.
Come on.
It is made to go on a cross.
Come on.
It is made to go through a borrowed tomb. It is made to go in the portals of death.
Come on.
And it is made when the hand was nailed, it was being equipped to snatch the keys of death and hell.
Oh.
And the end of the book says an angel.
Come on.
An angel.
Come on.
An angel will cast Satan into the bottomless pit. Just an angel.
Come on.
So I need to tell you, Pastor, that the battle is really over already. You just need to know how to celebrate. Join with us and hook your faith to this wagon. Let me just say this, Bishop, in closing. A black man, a eunuch, went to Jerusalem to pay taxes. That was what was on his mind. But there's a whole civilization of people that needed the gospel. And I'll tell you this, they were connected to Ruth. They were connected to Rahab.
Mm-hmm.
Because salvation is of the Jews. And Jesus brought salvation. But this black brother, going all the way through the desert, just a black man, probably the only one in Jerusalem, paid tax, going back in a desert place, God says, hold your horses. And picked Philip up out of a revival, puts him in the desert place with this lonely eunuch, and ministered unto him. And I want to say this to our brothers on the phone. Whatever ignorance, lack of faith, or fear that you're facing right now, you just need your eyes to be open. And Pastor, you mentioned open eyes. The guy's eyes was open. Philip said, do you understand what you read? And his eyes, all he needed was his eyes to be open. That's all he needed was his eyes to be open. All you need is your eyes to be open. Take another look at the situation again.
Jesus. Come on, man.
I decree.
Come on. Close up this thing. Go ahead.
I decree by the power of El Elyon.
Whoa.
That today is your last day of fear.
Come on.
Intimidation.
All right.
Any kind of rejection, anything you're feeling, this is the last day. Arise, my brother. Arise, my sister. Look not on the circumstances around you, but look at he who has not just the keys for death and hell, but he is the one that Satan has to have permission from to do anything in this earth. And listen, I believe the blood of Jesus Christ is covering you right now. And we're just gonna touch, we're just gonna link, because the Bible says where two or three agree. And I'm gonna ask Pastor Lamont just to lift a prophetic prayer right now. Let me say something here. We talked about a lot of things tonight today, but don't be fooled. The basis on which we stand is on the word and prayer and one God. The word and prayer, and how we're making it through COVID, all the paraphernalia and methodology is foundationed on prayer, the word. There's no easy way, and your faith in God. Don't lose your faith in God and fall on your knees. Don't forget to fall on your knees. That's where your strength comes. Go down before you can come up and let your faith do the walking. We want to prophesy.
Prophesy, man. We're going to close.
You have a word in your spirit. Just pray that prophetic prayer.
Close this up.
Release that prophetic anointing. Stretch your hands towards the screen wherever you are, whichever country you are, wherever you are. Maybe lying in your bed. Maybe a pastor, as Pastor Lamont said, you got very discouraged. Discouragement is part of it. But right now, as she begins to pray, reach your hands towards the screen. We're with you. We know what it feels like. Go ahead.
Go ahead,
Pastor.
Go ahead, woman of God.
Father, in the name of Jesus, the Son of the living God, right now I say that we believe and we are asking you now, arise, God.
Awesome.
Arise and let the enemies be scattered. Oh, when they come against us in seven, in one way,
seven.
We are going to scatter them in seven directions. We bind the forces of hell right now. We hook it up to the blood of Jesus. We dash the blood of Jesus right now. We give the Passover blood. The Passover blood is passing over every house right now. In the name of Jesus, there is a blood wall. There is a garrison of blood. The blood, the blood, the blood of Jesus. The name, the name, the name of Jesus. Oh, the power, the power, the power. Oh, the word, the word, the word. We bind you right now in the name of Jesus. We handcuff you to the word of God. We arrest you by the word of Jesus. We drag you out of depression. We drag you out of poverty. We drag you out of lack. We drag you out of self-pity. We drag you out of low self-esteem. And we raise you up in the power of God. We raise you up and we stand you high. We say you're coming out of the dust. Right now in the name of Jesus. And we say the address of the enemy remains the same. He lives under our feet. He lives under our feet. We crush him right now in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
Pastor, be strong. Bishop, be strong.
In the name.
Apostle, be strong.
In the name.
Prophet, be strong.
In the name.
Evangelist, be strong.
In the name of
Teacher,
Jesus.
Be strong.
In the name of Jesus.
Workers in the church, be
in
strong.
In the name of Jesus.
Every ministry, hallelujah. Every minister come is thriving better, brighter, bigger than you've yes. ever been before.
In the name
this
of
pandemic.
Jesus.
Is a launching pad
amen.
To take you into
amen.
A greater dimension of ministry
amen.
In the name of Jesus.
In the name of
and
Jesus.
They came out and there was none feeble among them.
In
the name of
Jesus.
Jesus. Amen.
Amen.
And amen.
Now you got to see this.
Bishop, may God bless you and anoint this ministry. And I pray we seize the atmosphere in this community
Jesus.
Over Great Britain. And over Ireland, Scotland, and over the nations of the world. We pray for our governments and our leaders. And we pray that the opportunity and the door of opportunity will be open for men of God to interact with our leadership. We pray for the peace of the land in which we live. That we will find peace in the name of Jesus. We take control of the atmosphere over our nation. We take control of the atmosphere over our homes, over our ministries. We take control over the financial realm and in the realms above us. In the name of Jesus, to the glory of He who died, was buried, and rose again triumphantly from the grave. I declare victory over this nation, over our houses, over our ministries, and over the lives of the servants of God. In the name of Jesus, amen. Amen.
Wow. Wasn't you blessed? I told you. I just knew. God would move tonight. We have gone over our time, 15 minutes. But you know what? The power of God was here. We have proven through the power of God that we have thrived beyond survive in this time of pandemic. Let me tell you, next week we're going to have two more men of God in this house that's going to bring the fire of God. They're also going to tell you exactly how they have coped and survived COVID. I thank God for these wonderful people, very good friends of mine. And it's just a privilege having you here, sharing with us, Pastor Dion, Pastor Winston, Bishop. I'm grateful coming all the way from Milton Keynes to be with us. You have been a blessing to many tonight. All the way from Greenwich. We're honored to have you both tonight, and I'm sure the people out there have been blessed. Please put in the comment. We're finishing now, but just please just say praise God, great night. Encourage us out there. Now look, I only can do this because you know God has been blessing this ministry, and you're the one that's been blessing us. There's more equipment that we really want to buy. As you can see, I've got a lapel mic, and we want to do more to the kingdom of God, and I'm asking you. We're going to put the donor box up. We're going to ask you, please. You were blessed tonight. There's integrity in this ministry. We've been going from, you know, from the day lockdown. And we're just grateful the amount of friends and the followers that have followed this ministry. We want to be transparent at all times. We're asking you to help us. Help us so we can enhance this ministry. And you know, it's not just helping Acts Christian Church. You know, I'm kingdom led. And I want to make sure that I can also bless other ministries. And we're hoping, and I'll say it on this platform, man of God, woman of God, my house is your house. There's something that's coming in your spirit that you need to get out there. And I don't have to go through no committee. This is God orchestrated. You come, use our equipment. I'll say that and send the message to the world. We're not defeated. We're not defeated. We are the head and not the tail. So I'm going to ask you right this moment. I want you. I will want it just to raise £800. That's the target. Simple. Maybe there's just one of you out there that just want to sow that. I'm asking you, please, bless this ministry that we can do more things. we can get more equipment that we can be bring our broadcasting. And you can see what a beautiful studio that we're in. Isn't it beautiful? We thank God for the technology, and we thank God for everyone connected to this production team working behind the scenes. We look forward to seeing you next week. I know you will be blessed. Watch the announcement. And I also do believe that, Pastor, there's a meeting coming up. This will be a great opportunity. Pick a camera. Speak to
ladies and gentlemen, but ladies, okay, I have my women's conference, my annual women's conference coming up on the 16th and 17th of this month for Reds Now. It is called Sequestered. Now, you have been hidden away, and you're coming out as a pearl. Now, I'm taking the thought of sequestered, that when in the oyster, in order for a pearl to be produced, an irritant gets on the inside of the oyster, and that's how the pearl comes out. You're coming out, ladies, as pearl. Wear something pearl on that day, 16th, and the registration is free, and you're coming out with a pearl. I need to see every one of you registered. God bless you, and see you, honey buns. See you.
Fantastic. Please, the announcement will be coming up, how to give, but please, just go the extra mile and bless this ministry. Wasn't it great tonight? God bless you. See you next week, same time, 7:30, on all the platforms. You will be blessed. The church will and has survived COVID. Bless you. God bless you. Speak to you soon and keep safe.
How to give by bank transfer. Our account number is 0310198. Our sort code is 309607. How to give online through our donor box. Simply go onto our website and click the giving tab. Then scroll down to the bottom of the page where you should find the link to our donor box. That will take you onto this page. Simply type in the amount that you'd like to give, for example £10, then click next. Enter your first name, last name, your email, your address and your postal code. Then click next. Then enter your long card number, the expiration date of your card, the security code on the back of the card, your billing postal code and then donate. And it's that simple.
Christian Church, where you're the head and not the tail.